Okay, so this week we've got a bunch more crazy names. I'm going to try to do this as best I can.
I did this on purpose. Just like to challenge the attitudes of tough guys.
This morning's scripture lesson is Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. Please listen for the word of God. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them this ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Thanks be to God."
Thank you. Let's pray. Lord God, come. Come with your Spirit upon you and upon your people. May the sparks of your grace turn into embers that flicker like flames and light up the night. May we be able to spread hope and warmth, light and joy to all people of the world. And may my words today help to kindle a fire in someone here in this church. Your holy name. Amen. All right, so it's Pentecost. Does anybody know what Pentecost means in its original Greek? Pentecost is actually the simple, it means, it comes from Penta, right, Pentagon. It is five, it's the 50th day. It is, in Jewish culture, it's the 50th day since Passover. And it was a festival of weeks. It's the seventh week after the resurrection. And in Christianity, Pentecost is known as the birthday of the church. It's when God sent his Holy Spirit to the people of the world. When John was out in the desert baptizing, he said, "I baptize you now with water, but one will come after me who is greater than me, and he will baptize you with fire." And we see this prophecy fulfilled in Acts 2. And it's always kind of been a strange and mysterious image for me. I remember read the story in Bible school, and you'd see a picture of all these guys here with flames on their heads. And it was really kind of weird. And you know, even after going through seminary, I think it's still pretty mysterious. So don't worry too much about making sense of this, but there's a lot of complex meaning. Before we get into what the fire means, because that's what we often use as the symbol of celebrating on Pentecost, is fire, I want to just talk about the straight message that's in this scripture. Because sometimes the fire aspect of it is so miraculous and so bright, we kind of gloss over the true message of the scripture. God's Holy Spirit comes upon the apostles, and they start speaking in tongues. Now, sometimes people talk about tongues as being a mystical language or something else, but the author of Acts is very clear. They're speaking in other people's languages. And the people around are really surprised. So surprised, in fact, that they think that the apostles must be drunk. Because it wasn't really usual for people to try to communicate in different languages. You might be forced to if you were a merchant or a politician. But diversity was not a virtue. Diversity in the ancient world was really more of a vice. In fact, a little side note, the word barbarian, which is our word for someone who's uncivilized, was a Greek slur for a foreigner. Because they thought when you talked in a different language, it sounded like they were just saying bar. And so they said, oh, he's a barbarian. He just isn't talking gibberish. And so to hear men talking to them in their own language, this is a culture where there were even strict religious and cultural rules against it. Greeks stayed with Greeks, Romans stayed with Romans, Jews especially stayed with Jews. They were proud of not assimilating into the culture. They had rules about not eating with people, all of their privacy concerns. And yet, here the apostles are reaching out to everyone, speaking in their own personal language. That's why this is so surprising. That's why this is so miraculous. And what I think the ultimate message is that the Spirit of God is common to everybody, is universal. It's accessible by everyone. And at the same time, it's also personal and individual. And it talks to us each in our own language. Now, why is this expressed in fire? I don't really know if the apostles, I saw a bunch of people with their heads on fire and be kind of scared. Maybe there was a radiant light around them, or something like that. But I think this image of tongues of fire is used by the author of Acts as more than just a description. It's a deep metaphor. Because fire, he's compared fire to the Holy Spirit. And fire is the oldest religious symbol we have, and the most universal. Fire was the first sacred force used by primitive man. Sitting around the campfire was the first liturgical setting. And fire does so much for all of us. It is what gives us warmth and heat and light. And it's used in so many different ways. Now, what's interesting is, it has all these meanings that we can draw out of it, that we can compare to the Spirit. But some of these meanings are different, and they're very contrasted with the pagan culture and the Christian culture. For example, in the Christian, the pagan culture, fire was something that was sacred and only belonged to the gods. Until Prometheus, this demigod, came and stole it from Zeus. And he gave it to human beings and turned them into civilized creatures. And then he was punished for it. He was chained to a rock, and he had his liberty every day. But in the Christian scriptures, fire isn't something that's stolen from the gods. It's something that God gives. Similarly, in the pagan world, fire was especially sacred fires, were something that were very private. They were in temples. Only the initiated, only the very special priests and priestesses could access them. Whereas this fire comes out of public. It's there for all to be used, to be enjoyed, to be experienced. And we see fire over and over again in the Bible. Whether it's, this isn't in the Bible, but in ancient tradition, Jewish tradition, the Torah first came around as holy fire in the beginning of creation. And then there's fire in the burning bush and the pillar of fire that guides the Israelites. The prophets are like Isaiah. Doesn't speak until his lips are anointed with fire. We have Pentecost and we have fire at the end of the world. Fire is this universal image with so many meanings, just as the Holy Spirit is universal. But it can be used in many ways and it has many meanings to many different people because it has individual relationships. God. Now, I just want to go through quick how to get this fire going. Because it's not always easy. Just because you have some sparks doesn't mean you have a fire. Even if you have a flame, if you've ever seen someone take a lighter and try to light a log on fire, it's not going to work. It takes preparation. You have to be aware of your environment. You have to gather your materials. You have to separate out the good dry wood from the old dead bad. And in our spiritual life, we also have to be aware of what's around us, what's good and what's bad, and separate out the positive influences from the negative influences. And then to start a fire, you need three elements. You need your heat, or you need your fuel, you need your heat, and you need your oxygen. The basics of fire. Even though there are many different ways to start a fire, there's over 150 natural ways to start a fire. All ways require fuel, oxygen, and heat. And for our purposes, fuel is giving something for God to work with, is being prepared to receive the Holy Spirit, being passionate about the world around you. Fuel for the fire, in a way, is love. Love for God, and love for what we do through prayer, and love for our neighbor, what we do through charity. Fuel is the work, and who we are. And then oxygen is kind of this mysterious thing. Oxygen is where the Holy Spirit actually comes in. It's divine nature. If you've ever seen someone fan a fire, you can turn a whole bed of coals into a blazing fire. It's almost miraculous. Just through the power of wind. And what we have to do is you have to move the wood around to let the spirit flow, let the air breathe. We need to open ourselves up and allow God to work through us. And then finally, for heat, I would say we need that heat is friction. It's things rubbing against each other that creates energy. And when you're making a fire, this is wood against wood, it's sulfur against rock, it's flint against steel. When you're tinkering the fire of the Holy Spirit, it's the spirit versus the physical. It's when our Christian morality rubs against our societal values, when our expectations, our hopes, our dreams rub against our real life situation. It's when we come in conflict with other people. This causes the friction, causes the heat, causes the situations. And then, if we open ourselves up and let the oxygen in, let the Spirit of God flow, and we give it that fuel because we're willing to work, boom, we have a fire. We've kindled the Holy Spirit. So, it starts with a spark and ends with a flame. And that flame is a process that continues to be fed more and more. And that is what this church is all about. God's gift of the Holy Spirit comes to all of us as individuals, but we come together as a community and we build this church that burns for the Lord, that is a beacon of light to the world. We are this church, and we are like fire, like the Spirit. Something that is united, but diverse. We all have our own individual relationships with God, but we're all Christians. And so, I would encourage us to find that Spirit and nurture it until we are set free.